Alright, so a bit of a last minute decision. We're what, Sunday now, and in a week's time on Tuesday, I'll be heading down to Christchurch. Been meaning to rebuild this engine for a while. Funds just haven't permitted, so decided we're gonna probably just pull the engine out today. We've already got the gearbox out. Gonna check out our bearings, probably just throw a set of bearings in it, just to be safe, because it has had a little bit of bearing material in the oil on the last few oil changes, and it was quite a big event and quite a big expense to get down to Christchurch, so just trying to make sure everything's going to be, you know, reliable within our budget. So yeah, we've cleaned out our container there, going to drain it out, see what comes out, and we're going to go rip the engine out. So I'm just going to shoot to my brother's while this drains, grab his engine crane, rip into it. Shoot over to my brother's and let's get this engine crane. Oh, I can't be bothered pulling the engine out, but it doesn't take too long. Let's get into it. Picked up the crane, thanks to my brother. Alright, so having a look in here, we've got the odd little speckly bit. Nothing major. See what it looks like once this goes down. And in here we have a fly, two flies. Very convenient. And just a few little speckly bits. Probably nothing too bad. Actually looks better than the last oil change. So time to start ripping this bad boy out. So something I've never planned for is draining the cooling system on this. We've got two massive dash 20s. So I think we'll drain it into this bastard. I fucking hate coolant. Look at this shit. Right, so we are ready. Pull the sucker out. Exhaust is clear now, just need to get our bonnet up a little bit higher. All right, here we go. So, gonna rip the sump off of this, flip it upside down, and rip all the timing gear off, and just have a little look, see what's going on with this beast.
So, do the timing gear first, I think. One thing that's always crazily tight on these 2Js is the crank bolt and the ATI harmonic balancer. Now, one thing I learnt only just recently is that when you buy these ATI harmonic balancers, you're supposed to send them down to the machine shop with your crank and get the inside honed out so that it's a nice press fit, because when these come, they are an insanely tight fit. I actually learned this off Rad Dan on one of his, I think it was an Instagram story or something. My mate tagged me in it anyway, and I was like, oh wow. So I must not have read that in instructions or something. So that's always been like a major to pull off. And on a factory 2J, what I've found is when you take this off for the first time, you need an unreal amount of force. Like, I had pretty crazy power bar on this engine before I rebuilt it. It was at least out to, you know, pipe on it out to there easily. I was just swinging on it. I was just like, wow, something's gonna break, but it was sweet. So let's buzz all that gear off, get the timing gear off, start going into it. So this is a custom made tensioner using a Subaru bracket. Got two big long pieces in there, and yeah, custom mounted alternator, because we had the alternator over there, the alternator wiring melted going past the turbo, so I was like, well, fix that by smashing that over there, and it's been pretty mint. Now, these are reverse thread from memory. And I really am due to getting you about. It's gone squeaking like shit. You can see once it goes shiny in the middle grooves there, usually pretty toast. This gun's probably not grunty enough to crack that bastard off. Come over here. I think this is 1,000 newtons. This is a beast anyway. Goes up to, I think it's 1,000. I like it. I like this tool. Oh shit. Battery on this is, must be getting down 1 bar. Oh, go get my charger. I might have to crack it by hand. Right, so this one's got 2 bars. See what a shed can do. Suppose, yeah, it's on full power too. There we go. What a beast. So you guys, my dedicated, I think it was these ones here. Or was it the long ones? Dedicated pulling set for 2Js. Wrong bolt. Now, a little trick for new people on 2Js. It's pretty much, see that little tab there? If you pull that timing sprocket out in your tone wheel there, especially the massive one for the VVTI, which has a lot of teeth on it, if it so much as touches that, throw that away. Chances of getting timing errors after damaging the tone wheel, even just the slightest, if you dropped it from that high, I'd still replace it. That's how finicky I've found them to be. Now, I do a little trick with this one here. It's because they rattle loose. Do put a weld on the back of it, which I'll show you guys soon, and slide off our precious little timing gear. Right, so as you can see on our timing gear here, I've welded in three places, and that's because this tone wheel has a possibility of actually spinning on the crank gear. So just a reliability thing, if that thing spins, it's not going to destroy your engine. Well, initially it won't, but if it spun a little bit and stuff to timing up, then yeah, it would. But in general, if it's spun, your engine's basically going to stop because the crank sensor has no more reference of exactly where the crank is. Very important, do not damage this. This here is a 12:1 timing tooth, and the VVTi ones might be like 58 or something teeth. Do not damage a VVTi one. So this here is a rather important piece to keeping a 2J reliable. This is a billet tensioner. So the factory tensioner has the possibility of basically snapping off this this tensioner arm that the pin of the hydraulic tensioner pushes on. Just crack somewhere around through there, lose tension in the timing belt, skip teeth, and then if you've got aftermarket cams, you'll smash your pistons into your valves, which in this case, this is an interference engine with aftermarket cams. But if you're really lucky on a factory 2JZ, your timing belt will just skip some teeth and your pistons won't hit the valves, because factory, these are a non-interference engine. Very important little piece. Stay there. Number one. And lock to that side. Beautiful. This is the part I kind of dislike. Let's get this crank out of here. All right, so we've got our crank out. All of the bearings are actually looking really good. I'm really happy with them. They're a little bit worn, but nothing like I was expecting. This engine has been producing a few little filings over the past little while, so been real keen to check it out, and actually really happy with what we found. So I'm gonna whack all the new bearings in, and we're gonna check the clearance on probably number one main journal, and probably number two conrod, and just check that out, our clearance versus the crankshaft. Tolerances are correct. From memory, I think that these bearings were about 1.8 thou clearance when we first built the engine. I was aiming for about 2, but 1.8 thou fell within the factory specs anyway. So let's get these new shells in, all cleaned up. Run out of bench space, but the next thing we want to do, so we're on the floor, so we're going to give our big conrod bearings and our mains a clean. Now see, there's two different packets here. One of these will be the top bearings and one of these will be the bottom bearings. So these here are going to be the bearings that go on our caps, because there's absolutely no oil groove hole on there. So if you put these on the block, you're not going to be able to have oil flow into your crankshaft. And you can see on these ones here, there's a nice hole there for oil to feed through out of the block and then feed around the bearing to lubricate your crankshaft. And on the 2Js, one of these bearings, this bearing here, sits a number one journal. It's a little bit fatter. So on the back of all these bearings, well, on the entire coating of them, is a film of oil. And like I said previously, on the back shell of the bearing, you want to get rid of all of the oil, because the oil is like a layer in between the bearing shell and the block. Getting rid of that oil helps the heat transfer out of the bearing straight into your block and then into the cooling system. Just helps heat dissipate faster. Right, so we've got all our mains here and our conrods here, and they're both standard compared to all the part numbers, and this is the same to all the old ones. So now we're going to get the main cap number one and bearing cap number two for the conrod, and we're going to torque them up, insert the bearings, torque them up to spec, and then we're going to do a little bit of measuring. And if those measurements work out within the specs that I'm happy with, then we'll just be assembling the engine. Now, if this was a brand new build, and ideally I would like to check the spec on all of them, but it's quite time consuming, and I'll be very confident that if one is correct, the rest are all going to be sweet. So we have main cap number one and bearing cap number two. Now I'm only going to clean these surfaces because I don't want to row off my numbers, and this is straight out of the engine. It's really clean as it is. Simple as, rip your bearings out, just push down on the side that doesn't have the tabs, and out she comes. Same here. Bit of a wipe with some brake clean to get any oil, grease and dirt off of that surface. And same with our conrod. Now same thing to insert our caps. So because this goes on the bottom of the block, this is the cap that goes on the bottom, it does not have an oil feed, so we will be using one of the bearing shells that has no holes in it, no grooves in it. And all of number one has a thicker bearing than the rest. Hopefully you can see that there. So we'll be slipping that into here. Just push it into the little tab there and then slip it on down. And that's that one all done. Now for our conrod, for the cap, all of these bearings here are the same. They've all got an oil feed hole on them. It doesn't do anything on the bottom. It's just, you can use them anywhere basically. Same deal, insert it into the tab and slip it on in. Let's head over to the block and we'll do the same. Alright, so big number one, slip them in there. And the reason I've chose bearing cap number two is because it's already high. I don't have to mess with any of these heights of the pistons, because when you put the crank in, when all the conrods are like this, it is a little bit difficult. This is not the ideal way. Usually the pistons and conrods would go in after the crank's installed, but in this case we were just doing a bearing checkup. Install our cap. Now lock always goes to lock. See a little tab there that's pushed in there, so you can't physically, well, you can get this around the wrong way, but you shouldn't be able to. So now we've got our number one main cap on and number two big end bearing cap on. I'm going to torque these up to spec and then start measuring them. There we go. 43 foot pound. Now we can start doing our measurements. So today I went out and purchased a micrometer. Unfortunately, I couldn't get a Michitoyo in town. And the one I was going to borrow, he couldn't find it. So our first step, we are going to measure the number one main journal. And then we're going to record that reading. And got the same reading, 61.99. Now we'll move on to our number two journal. So, and we'll see what reading we get out of this bad boy. Spindle, 51.985. Yeah, pretty much 4 or 5. Yep. 0.065 mil. Which is 2.55 thou. 2.55 thou on our conrods and 2.16 thou on our crank. That's pretty good. Happy with that. So now we can assemble the engine. Don't hop on my engine stuff, please. And kaboom. Fuck you, cunt, just die. Chuck all of our main bearings in. So you can see these have a hole in them that the oil comes out of that hole of the block and feeds the crank. And like I said before, number one has the bigger bearing in it. And number four has the two thrust bearings on it. So we've given all this a clean, full brake clean, and a wipe down. Mint. Now, not gonna lie, this is the part where I'm shitting myself, so. The last time that I did this by myself, I got my hand stuck. It was on another engine, like an RB or something. I was stuck down there, I was like, so I really hope that doesn't happen on this one. Wish me a lot of luck. Might just need to hook these on first. Then rotate the crank. Get those ones on. And come on, baby. Whew, man. Whew, that was not fun. Alrighty, so number one, lock to lock, which is like that and that. Number two, lock to lock. Now with the locks, you'll always find the locks will either be on that side or on that side. So it's pretty easy to know. So the other thing that I didn't tell you about these locks is they stop the bearing shells physically spinning. So that lock there is pushing into that side, and that lock there is pushing into that side. Whereas if we had a full round bearing, like what these talk about spinning a bearing, which you can still do on these, but those locks help stop all that to an extent. Now I want to make sure we pull these caps up evenly, otherwise they'll cock over into our locating dowels and we'll be in the shit. First torque is just literally seating them. When you're torquing things, you want to get a nice fluid motion. You don't want to start from here and then only just get to there and then it clicks. That's different because that was already torqued. Now we'll bring these ones here up. Okay, now onto our final torque, which is 43 newton meters. That's 44.2, back it off one. Oh, sorry, 44 foot pound. It's right there, 44.2, and back one. 43. number one done. That's number six done. And that's 2 and 5 done. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That is all of the conrods torqued. So now to do our mains. Now we do this in 3 equal steps up to 60 foot pounds. So last we can go to was 29.5. So 60, so we might as well go up to like 30. And our final torque, 60 foot pound. Beautiful, fully torqued. Now make sure you wind your torque wrench down once you're done. So that should. Rotate quite easily. So we'll get all this covered up. I know that it's torqued. One more thing we need to check is our thrust. She'll do that quickly. If we go like that and that. Yep, 12 there, and 14, which I'm pretty sure we had 14 before. Now if we convert that, 5.5 thou, I'm happy with that. That's what we set it at when I first built the engine, and it's happy as. Time to get our oil pump on using the world's best gasket sealant, 3 bond. Beautiful. Get this crank gear back on. Now always chuck a little bit of this on there. Some copper grease. Especially in the keyway hole. Magnificent. I also like to put a little bit of copper grease on our tensioner bolt just to let it lubricate in there nicely. And because this bolt here actually goes into an open hole into the oil gallery, I do put a little more Loctite on than I usually would, just to help act as a sealant. It's actually fully, so that's a shitload of Loctite. Generally wouldn't do that. And the other thing is just to check that moves nice and freely. I've had one of these before that was quite like real tight. Don't know why, but I ain't got another bolt for it, and it was sweet as, so just something to be a little bit careful of. So technically our timing marks on the cams haven't moved because I've actually locked them in place, marked them on the timing belt, so we need to rotate our crank round just a little bit. So back at TDC, all our marks should line up. Quick little inspection of our timing belt. Pretty happy with this. This is the Gates racing belt. Don't know if it makes a difference, but it's supposed to be able to handle the temps a little bit better. It's a little bit extra, it's safe insurance, I guess. So we'll get this tensioned, remove our bolt from there. So now we're ready to start putting our sump on. Oh. Some more three bond. So when I'm doing my siliconing, I just like to fully fill up all of those grooves. And try not to put a massive amount on, because the more you put on, the more it's gonna squirt out the sides, and the more chance you've got of silicon going through your engine, blocking things like your pickup up, then going, if it gets through that, then going through your oil filter, etc. All right, we are ready to go in. One other thing I do, just to be 100% certain, is where you've got joins, just put a little bit extra there. O-rings in. Sump's ready to go on. Right, time to rotate our engine around. This will be fun. Done. Right, so we've got the engine back over, gonna peel off our rock covers because the gaskets need replacing, and also gonna check all our valve clearances. Now I believe the clearances that we're looking for is 10 thou on the inlet and 12 thou on the exhaust, just off the top of my head. Tight 10. Ten and a tight 10.
Okay.
10 and a tight 9. And a 7T. So, looking here, a lot of our exhaust clearances have closed up by roughly 2 thou, 2 to 3 thou. I have to check my specs, but I believe these are 12 thou. And our intake, it's pretty close, 9s and 10s for the gist of it, an 8 there. Yeah, in general the engine is looking pretty good. The only thing we can really do now to check is pull the plugs out and do a leak down test on it to see how our ring seals are going. Our rings are sealing, but I haven't got a leak down tester here, and engine still sounds pretty crisp, so not going to stress too much about that. Got another set of plugs we might throw on it, but let's get these cam covers back on. Some new gaskets. Hopefully we've got rid of our oil leak. Right, show you guys a little trick so you don't break your spark plugs. I have seen it tons of times. I've seen people say you don't need to do that. They're full of fucking shit, bro. They're full of shit. Use a universal when you're undoing spark plugs. What it does is if you cock over, you're not gonna break the porcelain on the spark plug when you hold your whole extension falls over. I've used Universe on doing spark plugs for years and never had an issue.
All right, ready to put the engine in.
She is looking good. So we just put a new, didn't she, but put a new dash 12 drain on our turbo. So with MEC turbos, the 6868 turbo, which is a journal bearing one, has a dash 4 wheel feed and it requires a pretty large drain. So we've fitted a dash 12 drain. We had a dash 10 in there and it's just a little bit small. I think that's the reason why we're having a little bit of smoke on decel. And that is the specs that really should have been in there from day one. My bad. So let's get this puppy in the hole. Engine's in, bit of a mission. The engine, the gearbox just hits on the tunnel when we try to put the whole unit in. In the past we put the gearbox on after. But that was faster than jumping under there, throwing the gearbox in. Let's start getting all the little bits and pieces hooked up. We can fire the beast up. Woo! It's hot. So we've got the cooling system bleeding up at the moment. Got oil in it. I've disabled the engine. There's no spark plugs in it. And our switch on the bonnet there. I'll switch that off so there'll be no ignition. Let's put the jump pack on the battery because these drift bits have a switch on them. I forgot to switch it off. Need to get it wired into an ignition source. So yeah, let's see if we can get some oil pressure in this, then fire it up. All right. So just went up to about 70 psi of oil pressure. Just going to let that drop back down to zero. Then we'll let it pick up some oil pressure again. Put the spark plugs back in, I'll be happy as. So pretty happy with that, 80 psi on cranking. Spark plugs time. I think we're ready to fire it up. Feel a little bit sorry for the wife and the kid. It's a bit late at night, 10:30, so fortunately we've got to get this thing going. So I need to know that everything's sweet because we're shooting off in one day, so we've got tomorrow to pack, which is Monday, and then early Tuesday is starting to head down. All right, let's give it one more cycle. Volts.
bloody cold start. Never ever got that sorted yet.
So got really good oil pressure, happy as of that. Pretty much 100 psi. And our alternator's charging really nicely, so 14.2.
Expecting a shitload more smoke to come out. Obviously we've had the engine upside down, all the oil sort of goes past the rings into the cylinder head, but that's nothing, that's more just condensation.
A bit of a drink. So one thing I've learned about bleeding up 2Js is they need pretty high temp to get all the air out of them. So we usually have to get this up to maybe 96 degrees, almost 98, sort of tethering on boiling point to actually get it to bleed out the air inside of the engine. It is a bit of a bastard, but it has been absolutely mint ever since we put the 3 radiator set up in. But before that, it was like pulling teeth. It was painful. So I'll top that back up. Just check our oil level again. I'm pretty confident it will be pretty sweet, but yeah.